Yes. I want to welcome and acknowledge as well former Minister of Education, Reverend Ronald Thwaites, and the other distinguished guests who have been presenters in the past at this lecture. The Samuel Carter, the Archbishop Samuel Carter lecture was conceived some years ago to mark the founding of Campion College, which took place in early January of 1960, 64 years ago. And as you may know, the Jesuits founded this school as a high school for boys, a private high school for boys at the time, and Samuel Carter was our first principal. He didn't stay here too long, maybe 3 or 4 years, and he moved on to be rector of the Jesuit community at St. George's at Winchester Park before being appointed auxiliary bishop and eventually Archbishop of Kingston. However, this lecture was conceived to keep his memory at our forefront as the founder of our school. And it was conceived as a lecture to be given by a distinguished person, particularly in the area of education and character formation. Over the years, it has evolved to take in other issues as the issues in the society have multiplied, and we have not lacked for finding distinguished persons to present to us. Among our previous presenters have been Deacon Thwaites, Professor Trevor Monroe, Reverend Burchell Taylor, Deacon Peter S. Butte, who is with us, Dr. Lloyd Barnett, who is with us again this afternoon, Professor Errol Miller, Professor Michael Taylor, Archbishop Howard Gregory, and Mr. Greg Christie. Mr. Christie, Deacon X. Butte, and Professor Taylor are all alumni of Campion. And so, but we have gone outside and had alumni of other schools to present to us at this lecture. We, as a school, pride ourselves on providing a quality education to our students in both academics and in other areas. Our aim is to produce graduates who will serve our country and our community in an exceptional way. We emphasize the building of character as important as anything at any exam results will show. So I want to, again, welcome all of you this afternoon to this lecture. And I'm going to hand over now to Mrs. Grace Baston, our former principal. And I should also acknowledge Mrs. Baston as a former principal and our current principal, our acting principal, Dr. Lavere Henry, his vice principals, and the staff here at Campion who are with us to some extent this afternoon. And thank you all again for coming. Thank you.
I believe Mr. Thompson, having done such a fine job of acknowledging all our special guests, I can say good evening, everybody, friends all. It is my pleasure to hail Campion as it observes the 64th anniversary of its founding this month. Thank you. And I do so on my own behalf as its soon-to-be retired principal, yay, but also on behalf of the Most Reverend Donald J. Reese, Archbishop Emeritus of Kingston, who is also the chairman of the Archbishop Samuel Carter Foundation. The foundation is very pleased to continue to collaborate with Campion College in presenting this annual lecture in tribute to the memory, the life, and legacy of this great Jamaican. As our Pentecostal brothers and sisters would say, this mighty man of God, brilliant son of Ignatius, this colossal figure in the Caribbean church, and Campion's founding principal, the most reverend and honorable Dr. Samuel Emmanuel Carter, S-J-O-J-M-S-C-D, lit. And because Archbishop was such a master of Latin, I couldn't help but reflect on how many times the Latin word for great occurred to me as I prepared these brief remarks. Magnus, great, distinguished, mighty, bold, high, big. Because it reminded me that I was lectured by my own high school principal, Sister Mary Bernadette, who frequently despaired of what she called my abysmal ignorance. When I did not know a certain word, I was reading a passage and it said, shun pusillanimity. And of course I stopped because I'd never heard that word. What is that word? Who knows that word? Of course, this is a word that's a normal part of her vocabulary. So she says, why has everybody stopped? I said, because sister, nobody knows that word. She says, oh, and the palpable, the exasperation was palpable. She says, child, you must know pusillanimity. From the Latin pusil, small. Petty, this is how the face make up to you, you know. Little, and pusillus, weak, cowardly, timid in spirit, lacking confidence, fearful of taking risks. That is pusillanimity. And certainly, she continued, because she wasn't sure she had rescued me from the abyss of ignorance. Certainly, you know its opposite, magna, big, high-minded, she said. Magnanimity, greatness, bigness of heart, generosity, benevolence, kindness, forgiveness, selflessness. Well, whenever I think of Archbishop Carter, and I think that's part of my job from the foundation, is to let the people who didn't have the joy and the pleasure of knowing this man know a little about him. I remember a man who was the epitome of magnanimity. He was a big man, physically, especially as he aged, but his bigness was much more than his weight. He was a giant of a man. There was nothing pusillanimous about him or his leadership, whether of this archdiocese, the Antilles Episcopal Conference, the Caribbean Council of Churches, this school in its nascent years, or any of the long lists of organizations in which he served with such distinction. He was in every respect a great man. And yet the image of Archbishop Carter that made the most lasting, compelling impression on me as a teenager, I was only 10 when he became Archbishop, was one of him rising from his throne-like cathedral in the grandeur of the Cathedral of the Most Holy Trinity, removing his dazzling gold and white vestments and all the other symbols of his ecclesiastical authority and power, tying a towel around his waist, and bending his 70-year-old arthritic knees 12 times as he stooped to lovingly wash and kiss the feet of 12 humble parishioners on a Holy Thursday night. And as I watched him perform this ritual through the power of his symbolic action, I understood, without any need for words, what Christian greatness meant. I understood what Christian leadership meant. I understood that in that action was the summation of the entire purpose of Jesus Christ and his mission and what his discipleship meant. I believe in the words of the theologian Fiorenzo, discipleship must be lived in service and love. It must be lived as public witness, which indicts the hate and death-dealing powers of the world. Archbishop Carter, the indefatigable ecumenist, knew that dedication to this understanding of leadership and power and authority, which is love and service of the least, the defense of the marginalized, the promotion of justice, was a source of unity of all believers in Christ. 60 years before the current thrust for ecumenical collaboration, renewed call by the most recent Synod of the Roman Catholic Church, Archbishop chose as his motto, ut omnes unum sint, that they may all be one, a motto taken from the prayer of Jesus as recording in the Gospel of John. The Synod declares collaboration among all Christians is crucial in addressing the challenges of our time. This enables the voice of the gospel to have greater force. In the context of poverty, it impels people to join forces in the service of justice, peace, and the dignity of the least. In all instances, it is a resource for healing the culture of hatred, of division and war that pits groups, peoples, and nations against each other. I can think of no more fitting way in 2024 to honor Samuel Carter's life and mission than this lecture tonight on leadership issues in Jamaica today, delivered by another most exemplary and inspirational giant of a Jamaican leader, Mr. Howard Mitchell. God bless you all. And now let us pray. I just said to pray. I think I have to pray, right? Says so. So why don't we just pause for a little bit in the beauty and quiet and peace of this place to call to mind the many places in our world where this does not exist, where this freedom to gather and to think and to reflect and to feel safe is not present. We remember that as we pray. Creator God, you who formed us, you who send us, you who sustain us. We thank you for having called and sent and sustained our brother Samuel Emmanuel. We thank you for his bigness of heart, his generosity that allowed him to say yes to your call. We thank you for his faithfulness and courage in fulfilling his vows to you and your people all the days of his life. We thank you in particular today for his pioneering work in this great school. We thank you for all the daring and the risking that he undertook in those early years of our founding. We thank you, Lord, for all the seeds he planted that have borne such rich and abundant fruit today. And so we pray a special blessing, sustaining God, on this school community, its students, and all those who collaborate in their care and their nurture, its leadership, all staff members, parents, guardians, alumni, benefactors, that this community might always be grateful for its many gifts and generous in its outreach. And finally, enduring God, we pray your blessing on this gathering. The day is far spent, and like the disciples, we ask you to remain with us. May we recognize you in all the ways you may rest with us this evening, in the words of our lecturer, in our questioning, in our thinking, in our reflective silence. For we know that you are not in some far off place, not remote, not distant, but as this glorious Christmas season reminds us, you are Emmanuel, God with us. Amen. And I have to make a public service announcement. We are going to be using Slido when it comes time for the questions after the lecture. So you're invited to go to slido.com and to enter the event code Campion, not case sensitive. And these instructions will be repeated later on. Thank you, everyone. Good evening.
Ladies and gentlemen, my name is Diana Thorburn, and I'm not only a Campion alumna, I'm also a member of the board and a proud Campion parent. Welcome to you all. My task this evening is to introduce our speaker. When I saw that Howard Mitchell was delivering this lecture, I thought that's a great choice, and then I thought, I hope they ask me to be moderator again this year. But I didn't see any email coming in from Katie or from Dr. Henry. But I was going to come anyway, because I have all the time in the world to hear what Howard has to say. And pretty much everyone that I sent the flyer to said some version of that. Howard, I'll be there. No pressure, Howard. So why is it that I was so keen to be here? Why so many were so keen to be here? I've heard Howard say more than once that he's not an intellectual, but he's one of the smartest people I know. He is one of the most astute and insightful minds about Jamaica, Jamaica's problems, and Jamaica's solutions. He has firsthand experience in several areas of business besides his profession as a lawyer and working for some high-profile names, which he didn't put in the bio he sent me, so I won't say them. But he has been involved in pioneering industries in Jamaica as a leader and founder and builder of these companies, of Corpac Jamaica Limited, of Ajas, He chairs Island Grill, one of Jamaica's most successful local fast food franchises. And bridging his entrepreneurial mind and his legal mind and his public service, which is extensive, he helped to midwife Jamaica's first successful lottery, the Jamaica Lottery Company, and the predecessor of what is today the Chase Fund, the Sports Development Agency. His public service is unparalleled. He was an outspoken president of the PSOJ, who recently inducted him into their Hall of Fame. He was present at the creation of the Jamaica Accountability Meter Portal. He has been a chairman of the Mustard Seed Foundation and the St. Patrick's Foundation. And also something not in his bio that I don't know how many people know, but it was Howard Mitchell who got us the vaccines, when we, our first set of vaccines. But I think one of the reasons, or the main reason why he was invited to do this, was because of Howard's extensive experience in the background of Jamaica's political scene. He has advised prime ministers on both sides of the aisle, but he has been involved from every level of campaigning on the ground. I heard stories of him on the hustings in 1976, as well as was the chairman of the National Democratic Movement, which, though as a political party, it was not a success. I would ask anyone to debate me on the role of the NDM in transforming Jamaica's politics to be more democratic and less violent. So through his political involvement, he has traversed the highways and the byways, the hills and the valleys, talking to people at the top and at the bottom. And he has a great deal of understanding and empathy for both those at the top and the ordinary Jamaican. And I think the only other thing there is for me to say about Howard is that Howard is not afraid of mashing anybody's corn. And I am certain that he'll bring that forthrightness and predilection for telling the truth no matter what to this lecture this evening. He's a most fitting person to deliver the Archbishop Samuel Carter Lecture 2024. And now I will stop and let him do the talking.
Madam Moderator, since so much has already been said, much of which is hyperbole, I hope you'll allow me to save some time by saying all protocols recognized. And simply to say, good evening. I hope to at least entertain, and perhaps better, to challenge and to cause a little thought process that you leave here with. And with any luck, to stir up some sort of emotional but intellectual response to the questions and issues that are posed. So, good evening or good afternoon. My wife, I think it's afternoon still. My wife usually has that down pat. As a graduate of a closely related institution, St. George's College, and the father of two graduates of this one, I feel particularly privileged to have been asked here today. In fact, I sincerely hope that in assessing the quality of my offering, you will view them coming from a member of the family and not the hostile commentary of an absolute stranger. I am recovering from a cold, so I will sound even more emotional and whiny than I usually sound. But don't worry, we will manage through the course, if you'll bear with me. Today I want to ask you to think about the meaning, value, and significance of leadership in the development and successful establishment of a functional society, which results in the critical and essential wants and needs of its members to be satisfied and allows them to fulfill their God-given purpose. I would offer humbly my own opinions on the subject of leadership, but it is terribly more important that my words here today initiate and prolong your active and serious consideration of the subject matter, and ideally to prompt you to act to address the deficiencies which I hope to convince you exist in the role and function of our leadership in the 21st century in this country. Clearly, if I'm going to attempt to convince you of leadership deficiencies in the society, I must first say what I mean by leadership. And I must also attempt to show why leadership is so important in a society, so that you would at least value the 30 or so minutes that you spend listening to me and not regretting that you're not at home with your shoes off doing something else. So here goes. According to renowned management consultant Peter Drucker, leadership is about followership. Very simple. What I think he meant by that is that the quality of a person's leadership is only as good as the followership that he or she is able to generate by the lifting of vision to higher sights than the followers would normally see. The raising of his performance to a standard higher than the performance of those around him, and the strengthening of his personality beyond normal limitations. Therefore, leadership is that quality that allows someone to influence, direct, or command others by virtue of their perception of him and his influence over them. So let us agree that in looking for leaders, people generally look for exemplars of the kind of person that they themselves either want to be, or because it is innate in human nature to be part of a group, a team, a clique, a class, or a gang, to identify with characteristics or behaviors with which they empathize. They look to follow people who embody those behaviors or who appear to have those values that they admire. And this is why leadership is inextricably linked to followership, because people identify with those who appear to have the same values as they do, but also appear to be stronger, bolder, more confident than they are. If you are still with me on the conclusion, then it should be fairly obvious to see how Donald Trump manages to win at the polls and maintain popular dominance. It's because, rightly or wrongly, he reflects the views and captures the sentiments of a large percentage of the society, a percentage who feel he will defend the lifestyle and values that they see rapidly changing around them. Clearly, the USA has lost the original plot, just as we have. And both countries are getting the kind of leadership that encourages our fears rather than stimulates and inspires our vision. I submit that usually leaders are the reflection of the views and values and attitudes of their followers, or at the very least, that they are seen or perceived to be as very much of their followers like bigger and better and bolder. And the more united a society is around a particular set of values or fears or desires, the more attracted it is to leadership that purports to champion those desires. Conversely, if a society is divided, diverse, and unfocused on common goals, leadership becomes a more difficult proposition. The basis for leadership becomes more fragmented, and there is likely to be confusion. Hence, the observation that leadership is only as good as the followership. If therefore I could take you back to the eve of independence in 1962 And we were able to determine the best way to build a successful, functional Jamaican society. Wouldn't it not be obvious that we would fashion a society that identifies almost the same standards, that is exposed to similar values and attitudes, that equal opportunity is available to all, and that we wouldn't divide into tribes of green and orange? And that we should seek constantly to reinforce in our school, in our churches, in the workplace, certain specific and immutable principles and beliefs and behaviors that we believe will keep the society functional. Would we not red circle these values and attitudes and say we hold these truths to be self-evident, as the Americans did in their Declaration of Independence? And if we had done that with meaning and determination and understanding back in 1962, wouldn't that have made it more efficient to choose our leadership, because they would reflect the values that we believe in? Now, maybe we tried to do that, but somewhere along the line, we strayed off the path. And this applies to all of the colonies of Britain. We lost the plot, and we experimented with the contents of Pandora's box. And now, many of us in the Caribbean, many of the colonies are in the doldrums. We've lost the wind of nationalism that was blowing in 1962, and we are drifting onto the rocks of selfish individualism, materialistic greed, and uncaring ignorance of the rule of law. So how did Jamaica get here? Well, let me make it clear, I am not an academic, I'm not a social scientist, not a historian like my brother Sudin. I just have a lot of opinions, because I'm opinionated. Some of my opinions have been developed from reading a lot, and some are formed from 73 years of living on this rock that we call home. So I'm open to challenge at any time on my views. And I think Campion knows that they took a devil of a risk when they brought me up here. That being said, a bit of a history lesson. We started with the fact that we were a pirate colony of Britain. Henry Morgan, Thomas Modiford, and a gentleman named Abraham Cohen Henriquez built a substantial national economy on piracy and looting of the Spanish in the name of the British monarch, and successfully provided Spanish gold and silver to the 13 original states in America in exchange for goods which they sold in Europe and London. They made Port Royal the wealthiest city in the hemisphere, and they established for us a reputation of lawlessness and unbridled entrepreneurism. In other words, hustling and run-ins. And don't take my word for it. Read a book called The Currency of Empire by Jonathan Barth, and you will see in detail how complex and convoluted our piratical and money laundering origins are. Then came slavery. And while I don't ascribe every modern day evil or negative aspect of our physical and social life to slavery, there are three effects which, in my humble opinion, are undeniably built into our behavioral DNA. Firstly, the incredibly casual acceptance of brutality and violence. Secondly, the strong desire for charismatic and singularly pyramidal leadership over team effort and group activity, which has come about because the slave owners deliberately broke the strength and the spirit of any male who showed leadership, for that matter, any female who showed leadership characteristics, and only allowed the formation of teams and groups that served their purpose. Thirdly, the development of a matriarchal society arising from the above process of emasculation. So in 1834, when emancipation was allowed, we were a broken, dysfunctional, spiritually damaged set of people. And what did our British masters do then? In a brilliant example of social engineering, for their own purposes, obviously, they established the Negro Education Grant by Act of Parliament, the purpose of which, in the words of former Prime Minister Lord Howick, the second Earl Grey, was to solve the great problem of drawing up any plan for the emancipation of slaves, to devise some mode of inducing them, when relieved of the fear of the driver and his whip, to undergo the regular and continuous labor which was indispensable in carrying on the production of sugar. And I'm indebted to Mr. Robert Gregory for leading me to this area of our history. And I think it's fundamental when you want to understand our education. We structured, in many cases, with the cooperation of the churches, a two-tiered educational system geared at producing at one level hewers of wood and drawers of water, and at a higher level, so as to ensure the continuation of an elite class of administrators, merchants, and professionals who would, in loyalty to the crown, continue to provide wealth for it in the colonies. Ladies and gentlemen, that educational system and strategy has continued for over 190 years and still sits on our shoulders like an evil incubus, a monkey on our back. We still have, despite ongoing efforts to transform it, a two-tiered system of education. And what's worse, the two-tiered system that we have now is not even producing literate and numerate hewers of wood and drawers of water. Nor to any great extent is it producing relevant practitioners of the skill sets that we need for artificial intelligence. We have therefore designed and built citizens who, without strong, positive coping mechanisms, follow us, who have no clear idea of the values and attitudes that go towards the establishment of a thoughtful and progressive society. Ladies and gentlemen, we've all heard that leaders are born, not made. That is a cruel shibboleth. It is a lie. All great nations have established programs that deliberately nurture and educate leaders into leadership. For centuries, the Chinese have selected and groomed leaders for their political and commercial institutions. As for the British and the Americans, what do we think Oxford and Cambridge and the US Ivy League colleges are, except leadership incubators, values and attitudes indoctrinators? So, where's the leadership in training institution for the Caribbean? In 1948, when the University College of the West Indies, now simply the University of the West Indies, was established, its potential for leadership training, leadership and leadership training, was the great hope. In fact, the UWI has produced great leaders, but I submit, not by deliberate design, but by merely providing the atmosphere for a high standard of education to those with innate leadership capacities. Question in my mind is whether the university remains the repository and fountainhead of Caribbean values and attitudes that it was supposed to be, and indeed for a number of decades was. I've asked this question before, and unfortunately I am not satisfied that the response I got was adequate. The hard truth is that leaders shape societies, and for that to happen, leaders must in turn be shaped by societies along the design lines that are functional and appropriate for development. Our educational institutions have failed to do that to a great extent. I'm not denying the successes. I can't stand in the halls of Campion and say that Campion has failed. It has not. It is a prime example of how to produce functional people for the society. Part of the problem, though, is that we do not build into our educational curriculum beliefs and behaviors that are functional and useful to the development of a Caribbean society. Leaders who build unity and avoid tribal division, or at least restrict the tribal behavior to the arena of the tribal contest every 5 years, and who don't live tribally, breathe tribally, and if you cut them, bleed tribally. What is our success rate there? And I submit it's not great. What efforts are we making to train and incubate nationalists and patriots, unifiers, not selfish, highly competitive individualists who will win at all costs? The cruel irony of our post-colonial education system is that it has perpetuated the aims and purposes of the Negro Education Grant of 1834, but it has also mimicked a political system that is not relevant to our needs as small island developing states. And we have taken on the trappings of a democracy that we have fashioned to serve in ways that are impeding truly equal national development and are more about the division of scarce benefits and spoils than about unifying Jamaica in the common cause of advancement of all of us and facilitating each of us to bring out the best in the rest of us. We definitely do need a system reset, not a cosmetic tweaking of our constitution to merely rid it of the monarchy and declare that we are a republic. Excuse me for 1 minute. Now, before the agents of the state descend on me and intensify the surveillance of my electronic devices and follow me from place to place, let me carefully state that I am not advocating any other system of government than a democratic one. Campion can remain calm. We are not here proposing revolution. I am, however, questioning whether we are making the best use of the one system that we have and whether or not our political directorate is using the democratic mechanisms and structures properly. I am challenging you to consider whether our parliamentarians are able to properly do the job that they were elected to do and now are being paid well to do for the first time at last, according to some people. And by way of example of my challenge and my concern, let us take a brief look at how our parliament operates. Both the upper house, the Senate, and the lower house usually meet once weekly on different days in full, and usually for half a day, unless there's a legislation of pressing importance, which seems to be rarely. They meet over 3 terms with breaks roughly equivalent to the school term, and they are always available to meet otherwise if there are pressing matters, which apparently is not often. Now, during the week, you have committee meetings that sit to deal with specific legislative issues. Cabinet, which is the supreme arm of the government's strategic and management function, and which is technically but not in reality, subject and answerable to the parliament, meets once a week, usually on a Monday. And I say it is not answerable in reality because typically The Speaker of the House and the government's parliamentary whip do not allow any unruly backbenchers to ask too many questions. During the parliamentary year 2021 to 2022, there were approximately 18 pieces of legislation that were supposed to be dealt with. Only 3 were finalized, 9 were untouched, and 5 were started but not finished. Ladies and gentlemen, the numbers for 2023 are not yet in, but I saw approximately 40 pieces of legislation mentioned in the Governor General's throne speech in February last year as being intended to be dealt with in the course of the year. I doubt very much if the rate of success was any different from 2022. Finally, I would hazard a guess that there are tens of bills which have fallen off the order paper without acknowledgement or even the dignity of memory. But what's my point? I am respectfully submitting that as followers, it may have slipped our notice that our leaders who we elect to lead us by, among other things, establishing and supporting the rule of law, have not been and cannot be performing that function very effectively. And that, ladies and gentlemen, is as much our fault as it is theirs. The simple reality is leaders are only as good as their followers. If followers elect leaders whose vision is imperfect, whose capacity is limited, whose integrity is doubtful, and whose commitment to national development is of low priority to their desire for power, their need for enrichment, and their attachment to their tribe, and if we do not equip them properly with resources and then hold them to a certain standard of attendance in parliament, attention to their legislative duties, and reporting to us, and failure will result. Successful national development and the maintenance of a democracy are not accidents. They can only happen if the right structures are put in place, the objective standards and objectives are stipulated and measured, and if consequences flow from non-performance. And please don't tell me about elections being the performance metric, right? Every 5 years, 37% are that kind of average vote to comment on the performance of the tribe. And of that, and we know how increasingly transactional, Dr. Barnett, that process is. Not accusing you of anything, you know, just referring to you as somebody who would know. I submit that functioning societies of generally democratic persuasion stand on 3 institutional pillars. Firstly, the institution of civil society, meaning the church, the schools, the communities, the courts, the various associations and groupings, and all the individual citizens. Secondly, commerce, the market, which is either usually highly regulated or free-reeling capitalist. And thirdly, institution, the pillar of the political directorate. And if all 3 of those pillars are functional, equally strong, focused on broadly the same goals and strategies, and are able to collaborate and compromise on differences, then the society functions well. To the extent that any one or 2 of them are weakened, to the extent that they lose sight of the common goals and direction, the society becomes deviant and dysfunctional. And I know that this is an oversimplification, but there's time and context. I'm making the point that civil society in the English-speaking Caribbean has failed to define itself in terms of meaningful, as a meaningful institutional pillar of the society. Commerce has been somewhat successful in compromising with the political directorate for its own purposes. Hence, politics is preeminent over social policy. And there is greater attention to commerce nowadays than the needs of civil society. Human capital has lost its voice and its position, and the emphasis on tribal politics has destroyed the fabric of communities. promoted a client-patron-dependent relationship with our citizens, and rendered us incapable of efficiently communicating with and maintaining the social guardrails and directional signs that keep our leadership on track. On the other hand, our political leadership has lost sight of the reality that true power resides in what social scientists are calling smart collaboration with other stakeholders, and many of them have fallen into the mental trap of believing that they were elected to rule rather than to represent. Accordingly, they listen to their self-serving tribal base, and they ignore even the basic norms of respect for their opposition counterparts, the media, and anyone who do not bow down to their posturing. Indeed, over the years, we have accepted without murmur the loss of shared standards, and we have accepted the deviance from those standards. Instead, we keep defining our standards lower and lower, defining them down, and accepting deviancy as being normal. And as a consequence, our democratic relationships have suffered. We no longer see people with opposing ideas as equals to be respected and contested with. We see them as enemies to defeat. Our political directorate adopts the behavior of dancehall entertainers and import vituperation and slanging and threats into the forum of parliament where they have no place. And by doing this, we have done a disservice to our democratic institutions. And it never happened last week. It didn't happen last month. It's been a process that we have sat by and seen and mostly accepted. The reality of our best and brightest people voting with their feet and escaping the deviant system is a fact. And we have failed to build the trust and social capital that is necessary. Instead, institutionalizing unequal education and walls of discrimination, turning a blind eye to enrichment and corruption because we either share in it or we are friends with it or we don't have the stomach to call it out. All of us are guilty before God, and any finger I point at you, I must also point at myself. If we are honest and recognize where we are and how we got here, the main things to do now is to spend our energy on how to figure the way out and decide who is coming and who is staying. And by the way out, I'm not talking about taking a fishing canoe to Panama and walking across to Los Angeles by way of Mexico, as approximately 2,000 of our people do every year, some of them dying in the process. We don't understand that the revolution has already occurred. And to paraphrase or misquote Gil Scott-Heron, it wasn't televised. They have rejected us. Hundreds of thousands of Jamaicans have said, I want to be no part of this. They have abandoned a system that only serves a few. So while we ponder on that human cost, there is another consequence to our inadequate followership and consequent substandard and low and shallow leadership. That is the danger to our political culture. It's undeniable that Jamaica is a democracy. Much sweat and tears have been expended to root our constitution and structure our political system in democratic soil. We've had some slip-ups and some near misses, but we are still a democracy. Having said that, the watchword must be eternal vigilance by us as followers, and we must observe our leadership for signs of the dreaded virus of autocracy. The reality is Jamaica has seen many of those autocratic tendencies over the years. Thankfully, not all in the same place and at the same time, or else we'd have a problem. But the watchword must be vigilance. Ladies and gentlemen, I have taken up much of your time describing a sad, miserable past, a difficult and challenging present, and implying a bleak and dystopian future. This is deliberate. This is deliberate. We have good things going about Jamaica, but I leave that to the Governor General to speak about. Okay? I need to kind of hold your face in it for a little bit. We need to face the critical truth. Jamaica has over 600,000 squatters, 750,000 people outside of the workforce. Our poverty rates appear to be increasing. The data is not clear yet. And as we see every day on social media, violent and deviant behaviors, the behaviors have become the norm. Only about 40% of our school leavers pass mathematics. 59% of them are functionally illiterate. A large percentage of our gun criminals, perhaps as many as 30%, are under 18. And our schools, some of our schools are holding pens for juvenile delinquents. Our environment is under serious threat. And our health system, despite benefiting from a great amount of funds, needs management. The challenges are multiple. And we have a system where the government is elected by 20% of the voting population and is faced with those challenges which require all hands on deck. Simple. And as civil society, our attitude is that government must work it out. That's what we put them there for. And the political directorate, on the other hand, many of them, reject the notion of smart collaboration with empowered members of the society because of a perceived monopoly on power and a paranoid reluctance to share it. It's not a pretty picture. For those of you who remember the Charles Dickens book, A Christmas Story, you'll recall that the author took Ebenezer Scrooge on a dream tour of his life, using the characters of the ghost of Christmas past, the ghost of Christmas present, and the ghost of Christmas yet to come. I have adopted that methodology because of its simple beauty. I have given you a glimpse of the past, a vision of the present, and I have implied a dismal future. But just like the ghost of Christmas yet to come said to Scrooge, I am saying to you, it doesn't have to be this way. It is late, but it is not too late. We can change it. Effort must be universal and collaborative. It will require our leaders to find extra energy, greater empathy, to reduce tribal warfare, and to inspire the collective. They cannot and must not be left alone to try and fix it. We must help them, and they must be open to help. Civil society must redefine the values and attitudes that as independent Jamaicans in the 21st century, we wish to adopt and be part of our way of life. And then we must teach them and live those values and those attitudes in our schools, in our churches, in the workplace, on the street, in parliament, in our homes. They must become gospel, lifestyle, habits. This is enlightened self-interest. It is in our own interest. If we do not rebuild our community spirit, if we are not more inclusive, if we do not create institutional channels for greater opportunities for the mass of our people, the pressure will be unsustainable. And pressure busts pipe. We are blessed that we have a government and successive administrations that have managed to navigate the dark waters of fiscal reform. So now, for the first time perhaps, we are seeing the ability to use our resources in the right way on our human capital. And if I'm going to be mischievous, not on so many highways and things, but on our people. I don't usually use long quotes, but I'm making an exception today and quoting the words of a leader who spoke in what was then the Legislative Council of Jamaica in 1962. I'm quoting him for two reasons: to show that there is no new formula for success and that it is what it was and what it shall be. And I'm quoting him to show how difficult a task we have. before us. In 1962, this leader said, "I will never cease to expand the thesis that independence must mean that not only a tightening of the belts, it must mean a closing of the ranks. It must mean that those who dwell far apart must draw nearer together, not for their own purpose, but drawing close with the aim of building. We live in not one, but two Jamaicas, a country stratified in such a way that there is a large gap that divides this country. It is the closing of the gap that we must first give our minds to if we are to achieve independence and not simply have a name which means little to the people. What we need is to take the existing institutions that we now have and with the new freedom be able to rework them into the fabric of independence. We have reached a stage where many of us look back to 1938 and say, what have we really achieved? If the hopes of the people are not to be destroyed as they have been in the past, if their hopes are to be replaced with a lack of confidence in the future, political systems that first created those hopes and now have created them once more in 1962, they will also lose faith in those systems. It is something about which I feel deeply," said the leader. "And I say that until there is no stratification that keeps a man in one sector by circumstances of birth, of color, of race, of wealth, and until there is not just freedom of the word, but freedom of social mobility and freedom of economic mobility, until these things help to transform Jamaica into one country, the independence that we have fought for will never be earned." Ladies and gentlemen, that speaker was the Most Honorable Edward Philip George Seaga in 1962. And where are we now? Most have died an unhappy man. I am therefore on the podium of one of our best educational facilities, pleading for you to lead the way in developing leaders for our times. The formula is long established. It is the leadership that we need to apply to it. Do not leave the process to chance. Redouble your efforts. Call for help to ensure that each child is leaving the school as a good follower, mindful of the right values and with high standards and critical mind, and with the tools to become economically upwardly mobile, or our leaders who are mindful of the needs of all their followers, who enlarge the institutions that create opportunity for all, and who believe in equality of mankind and are committed to the unity of our people. I want to thank you for your patience and for not getting up and going home.
Oh, I didn't realize you were there.
Thank you very much.
Down the lawyer just gave me the information. I didn't even know that.
Thank you so much, Mr. Mitchell. Can we get another round of applause, please? Okay, I'm going to let him catch his breath. And first of all, welcome everyone who is here online. There are several people participating and attending this lecture online. So thank you for joining us. And they'll also get to participate in the discussion that we're going to have now, because we are going to be using something called Slido. So this is courtesy of my place of employment, the Caribbean Policy Research Institute. It is an online platform where you can not only pose questions, but you can vote up other people's questions. So if you go and you see someone has asked a question that you want answered, you put your little thumbs up beside it. And then when I look at Slido on my end, I will see the questions with the most votes rising to the top. And this is a very democratic way of doing things. It means that people who shout loud don't get automatically to say what they want to say or ask their questions. And it also allows for the participation of people online. So slido.com, event code Campion, very easy, lowercase. And if necessary, I think I might repeat it one more time again, but it's fairly simple. Slido.com, event code Campion. And you can go ahead and start putting your questions in. I will see them, and yes. Mr. Hibbert, do we have a mic for Mr. Mitchell? So as I anticipated, I would like to just dominate the entire discussion and ask questions, ask my own questions and not take any. But, and I will use my prerogative to ask the first question, which is to put yourself in the position of this ghost of Christmas yet to come and tell us, who is this leader that we're waiting for? Not by name, just describe him or her, and what needs to happen in Jamaica for us to get this leader?
Well,
I'm not expecting a messiah.
I think that type of leader that we need at this point in time, and let me address it that way if you don't mind, is a leader that has the sufficient strength of conviction to accept that his or her own life could be wasted in pursuing the vision that they have, that all of his or her efforts must go into pursuing this vision, and who is rooted in the ambitions of our people, the understanding of our particular culture, and the ability to draw everybody around those understandings and that vision. Now, where you find that? I don't know, but I personally resist the idea of a charismatic leader. I believe in functional teams, and I believe that leadership can be shared and still held.
All right, we do have some questions coming in, but there is another provocative question I'm going to ask, and it's something you alluded to when you talked about the very slow pace at which legislation comes forward. And I've now been around long enough to see that things take such a long time to change in Jamaica. It's, for me, one of the most frustrating things about trying to get anything done here is you'll read a report from 20 years ago that says the same things, and it can even go further back than that. What is it about our leadership why we have failed to just bring about some of the most basic changes that would make this country better? What, and again, to kind of refer back to the first question, is how can, is it in our lifetime, are we going to be able to have a set of followers to follow a leader who's actually going to just do some, you know, what we call the resolvable unsolved problems, that, you know, whether it's changing the way we go about selecting jurors, or sending notices to people for jury duty, or, you know, some of the more fundamental things about the public health system, for example. What is it that we need to do to become better followers so we can get a country where things actually change and move forward?
Let me respond to that in two ways. One, I went called in. Lost the mic, can you hear me? I'm going to call names.
In my experience, Edward Seago had the clearest vision of the institutional structure of a society, and he did the most to implement those institutions that are necessary. Bruce Golding, in his 4 years, passed more reform legislation, got more reform legislation than any other prime minister I am aware of. Mark Golding, in his tenure at the Minister of Justice, did more to move legislation through than any other Minister of Justice that I am aware of. Therefore, it must be focused intent, a clear understanding of what you want to do, not what, how long you want to stay in power, or what Bobby Gregory wants from me, and I'm going to give him, I'm going to let him through, but a clear understanding that for the sake of the Lord Jesus, the building code needs to be passed. The new building code needs to be passed. The undeclared sources of wealth orders, which have been were committed to 3 or 4 years ago. Cabinet do not approve them yet. There is not a clear intent to do it, and it makes me very suspicious. So we need a leader with a vision of integrity, of confidence, and of purpose. Right? And we as followers must stop. I think this word was banned in Parliament, but I'm going to use it. Pussyfooting around. And require the performance of what is promised and what we have asked for. That is all I'm saying. We must have the clear sense of focus and purpose, and we don't.
Yes, I think so. It seems so. So we do have a lot of questions, and again, I'd encourage you to vote up the ones you want answered, because otherwise it's going to be up to me, which I don't mind, but again, something you mentioned in what you said, you alluded to the process of constitutional reform. Elaborate on that a bit. In all of the leadership gaps that we have, in the followership gaps that we have, in our slowness to change and carry reforms through, what is the role of constitutional reform in becoming better followers and getting better leaders?
Well, first of all, are you hearing me?
Yes.
The Constitution should be an item of curriculum in every school. It should be, to the extent that it needs to be, simplified in language that I can understand. Secondly, I challenge the notion that a constitution is an immutable instrument written in stone forever and forever until our Lord Jesus comes down. It must be respected, it must be preserved, but times change, paradigms shift, and therefore, to try and come back to where you were, because I have a tendency to stray. The role of the Constitution is the GPS of the society, and it is where you go to find your place and your direction. And don't come and tell me that constitutional reform is getting rid of an obnoxious monarch or an awkward king and calling ourselves a different name. That's not what it is. That's a cosmetic change. It's a outward manifestation of something that does not exist inside.
So what I'm hearing you say, without you saying, is that the current direction that we are going in and the current process that we claim to be engaged in with regard to constitutional reform is, we're not going across it like that.
It's inadequate.
Right.
It hasn't reached the people. People don't, well, I shouldn't say that. I don't have total consciousness of what the people of Jamaica want. But I suspect that if you go down to Bustamante Children's Hospital this evening and see the hundreds of people in the hallway and ask them how they feel about Jamaica being a republic, you may have to take steps to protect yourself.
Fair enough. So we have another question here about the democratic process. And one of the things you said was we can't use elections in Jamaica as a metric of desire, as a performance metric. And it calls to mind the quote, which has been attributed to many other people, that people get the government that they deserve, which kind of brings up the followership question. But that's a tangent. What is it about the way we do elections that is not giving us, again, this leader that we need? What is it about that aspect of our democratic process that, if we were going to say we're going to actually pass some legislation here, we're actually going to do something different and something effective, what could we do?
I've been a member of every established political party in this country since 1968. I have been involved in the compilation of manifestos for both for the NDM and for the other significant parties. And with no exception, manifestos are prepared maybe with luck 3 weeks before the election, and they are model of cut and paste, okay? And they are distributed like confetti, not read, and not that much spoken to on the platform, and certainly not adhered to the day after the election, right? So that elections, when I go to elect Senator Dana Morris Dixon, I expect her to tell me what she is going to do for the country, how it is going to impact my life, what it is going to do in terms of overall development, and why it is that she's making this a priority. And then I expect her to commit to doing it and giving me a timeline. Now, that has been done in the recent past, you know. People tell you that within 100 days of the election, so and so will happen. Or that this law is going to be passed this year. And when it doesn't happen, we just sit down and take it. We don't take it into account. We don't go into the little book we keep and say, Howard Mitchell said he was going to do this and he didn't do it. And the next time I see him on the platform, I'm going to ask him. Or the next time he walk past my house, I'm going to ask him. Why we do that? Because the culture is, it really doesn't matter, because no matter what, they are going to do whatever they want to do. And I might as well just get the money from them for the vote, right? And see what kind of job I can get from them later on. It has become transactional. It has become client patron. And this is not yesterday talk. It's getting to the point now where it is a stink beneath our feet, but it has been there. So the work of CAFE and the work of all the institutions that, I'm not turning to, that attempt to regularize our elections, or which attempt to formulate the kind of job performance or job requirements, that work must be accelerated and promoted and encouraged.
All right, so I have a couple of questions here which I'm going to combine. And I think the general concern here is about, and this is me paraphrasing, Jamaica's human capital stock, which,
I'm sorry, I missed the person.
Right, so the gist of these questions is about Jamaica's human capital stock and the concern that we are subsidizing other economies with our state-supported education that educates people who leave. I think it's 85% of university graduates, but are also failing to provide the leaders that we need. In the various, on the wish list of the things that we want to do to get better leaders, get better followers, what is the role of the education system and just our general approach to human capital development that we are not doing now that we could think about doing in a concrete way?
Okay. Couple of things. I've heard the sentiment that it is good for us to produce more nurses so that they can go to the United States of America or Canada and send money back. I abhor that. That is us reversing the middle passage, right? We produce people, let's take the nurses profession. Those are functional people, they're good, but what happened? We don't have the institutional structure to absorb them. And forgive me, and I am open to correction, but I believe there is a quota that is established involving the nursing council. And that's why sometimes nurses can't get jobs, even though there is a need, right? We need to look at those reform areas. Secondly, I think, and it's a process, and I'm just impatient of the process. We need to keep looking at our curricula with a view for the future so that we equip our students with capacities that are generally analytical and that they can match and adapt to changes as they come along, not set them on a road that they can't come off of without going back to school. Thirdly, I hear people talking about the shortage of labor in Jamaica and that we're going to import labor into Jamaica. I want to know what you're going to pay them. Because if you think you're going to get anybody from anywhere, and I say this not in a denigratory fashion, from anywhere except Haiti and pay them $400 an hour, I have news for you. And if you pay them more than that, people will tear down this society. So we need to understand that we better make our own. We need to do what is necessary, and we have to start doing it now, right? To give our children the analytical capacity to cope with the 21st century. Now, what does that, I'm not an educator. I can tell you that my profession, my chosen profession, law, that we are faced, and I'm going to get crucified for this, we are faced with a situation where we are producing for a market that does not exist. How much more lawyer we need, right? And if we're going to have to produce these lawyers because we have the institutional capacity to do so, let us produce them with a view to equipping them to do legal BPO tasks and to do offshore opinions. Let us deliberately fashion an industry for them to have them stop congregating outside the lignum vitae treatment at Maypen Hospital and waiting for the ambulance. It is demeaning.
So I hope all those who are submitting these questions are trusting that I am incorporating your questions into my synthesis here, because I'm trying to cover everything. And I think the gist of the rest of the questions are in two categories. One is, people want to hear some practical things. They want to hear you talk about some actual policy measures, some things that Senator Morris Dixon and Senator Golding can carry to Senate and actually do tomorrow when they go to Senate, right? And then there's another set of questions that is, wants to hear more about maybe the theoretical parts of it, like, what are the values that we should be promoting, that we should be working towards, that we should be endeavoring to have as national values that would take us forward? So I want you to think about it in those two terms. So as your kind of your last salvo, the aspirational, more conceptual aspects of where you think we should go, and some of the practical ways that people who are here, I mean, I think they said that 11 out of the, forgive me if I'm wrong, 70 plus legislators are Campionites. So you're in the right place if you want to be influencing policy to send directives to people. But yes, what are some of the aspirational, some of the conceptual, and some of the practical?
So I'm at my age, you're not very aspirational anymore.
Yeah, you're good.
Well, let me give you a practical, what I think is a pragmatic policy direction. When you leave this institution and you drive in a southerly direction and you cross You pass by Carib and you go, you cross Torrington Bridge. You're in a different city. Yet that city, if you value, if you go in and do a valuation of the human assets in that city, the cultural assets in that city, the musical assets in that city, if you take from Raytown, where the fish and the music were, Gold Street, where a sister has made a culinary island, come across East Street, where the history knocks you down, and you go to Water Lane and go across into Trench Town. There's so much value locked in there, and so many good proposals have been made, not for the re-gentrification of downtown Kingston, but for the revitalization of downtown Kingston. And there is a civil society organization, which I must mention, Kingston Creative, which has on its own and with tremendous opposition that I personally can speak to from the political directorate, has on its own shown the transformation, right? And this is, and that, if you, and don't tell me about gunmen and violence in downtown Kingston, if you reestablish the cultural practices and give value to the assets that are down there, cruise ship kill you in the harbor, right? You add 2% to your GDP as soon as you move off on it, right? Tourists would come in buses from the North Coast to participate on the way to the airport. You could change the structure of Norman Manley International Airport, right? Because nowadays people go for tourism for the cultural value. They go to Cartagena, which was the scum of the Caribbean. And when you go to Cartagena now, some simple tweaking and some uplifting of the human assets have made it into a substantial contributor to Colombia's GDP. As far as the other part of the question is concerned, what are the values and attitudes? I have no idea. But I certainly think it's time we ask the people whether them still want to deal with Howdy and Tenki, or what them don't want that anymore. I see attitudes and behaviors now in our young people that, by the way, I admire, because I never had those behaviors when we were growing up. They have coped. So we need to find out what they are, and then we need to decide whether we want to keep them, and then turn them around in the textbook and teach them. We need to examine that in our people. We are not introspective enough. We're always facing North America.
Thank you so much, everybody. Can you please give Mr. Mitchell a hand for being so forthright? And yes, I think it's time for you, Ronaldino, to come and say your thank yous.
Okay. Maybe you should start off.
I will. Why not? Ladies and gentlemen, all good evening. I would love to recognize, I'll try my best to recognize our important guests individually. So senators, the Honorable Dana Morris Dixon, the Honorable Shireen Golden Campbell. I saw former Minister Ronald Thwaites, other distinguished guests, Board Chairman Mr. Anton Thompson, outgoing Principal Mrs. Grace Baston, Acting Principal Dr. LaVere Henry, Vice Principals, teachers, staff, parents, students, friends, Campion family. Thank you for coming out, each and every one of you, to this annual Archbishop Samuel Carter Lecture. It was my privilege to be here to share in the knowledge and the prescient and prophetic words of our presenter, Mr. Howard Mitchell. I'm sure you'll all agree that it was intellectually rich, though he says he's not an intellectual. It was historically accurate, though he says he's not a historian. it was academic in terms of its sociology and its educational analysis, though he says he's not an academic, and it found the right space in Jamaica's, you know, almost chaotic and to many corrupt political arena, though he says he's not a political scientist. I want to thank him for sharing with us. I want to thank him for choosing this forum here at the Hub of Jamaica's Future, for breathing into what will be many of Jamaica's future leaders on such an important topic. I want to take the time to also thank those who helped to put this event together. I want to thank Mr. Anton Thompson, who brought greetings from the board and the Campion community. I want to thank Mrs. Grace Baston, who brought remarks from the Archbishop Carter Foundation. I want to thank Mr. Hibbert, Mr. Tolo, the audiovisual team for their help with music, with lighting, with all the other equipment that was necessary for this event. I want to thank our moderator, Dr. Diana Thorburn, Director of Research at Capri and board member, for so wonderfully moderating the discussion after Mr. Mitchell's presentation. I want to thank each of you again for coming out. I want to hope and I want to wish, along with Mr. Mitchell, that his charge for us today to envision the kind of leadership that we want to take Jamaica through the next stages as we look, you know, even as a fledgling democracy at our future. I want to hope that his charge resonated with us, that it inspires us, many of us who grow increasingly disaffected by our politics, many of us who leave, 85% of the educated population who, you know, for many reasons out of their control often have to leave. I want to hope that his words found a welcome place in our hearts and that we will all take it upon ourselves to work towards better leadership in Jamaica. Thank you for coming out. I wish you safety and peace back home. So am I supposed to sing that too? Okay. All right, please stand with me as we close with the school song. Mesa? Hail Campion, hail! Faith and courage will prevail. Truth, integrity, honor, liberty, these shall never, never fail. Shine, Campion, shine. May you ever be a sign that within our land we bring heart and hand, reaching out in love and unity. Rise, Campion, rise. Raise your banners to the skies, with your red and white leading to the height, ever onward, upward rise. Sing, Campion, sing. To our island may you bring champions pure and bold, like our saints of old, brave and loyal. Hail, O Campion, hail. Thank you.
Thank you.